Hello, this is breaking news from 7 News. A major development in the search for missing Sydney couple Jesse Baird and Luke Davies. We're taking you live to a police press conference.
Of Luke Davies and Jesse Baird. Today, this afternoon, detectives attached to Strike Force Ashfordby have located a second crime scene in Bungonia, which is a separate location to the scene that they had been searching yesterday and earlier. And at that location, we believe we have located two bodies. The families have been informed, and crime scene detectives have just arrived on scene at that location now, where a specialist forensic investigation will take place. So on behalf of the New South Wales Police Force, I'd like to pass on my condolences to the Davies and Baird families, their friends, and the LGBTQI plus communities in not just New South Wales but across Australia where they were based and have many friendships. I'd like to thank all the detectives that have worked hard on this investigation tirelessly around the clock, not just the detectives and the OIC detective who's here today, and credit much of the success of the case to her. Thank you. The commander of the homicide squad and the commander of state crime squad, but also the many specialist resources that have been involved in supporting the investigation. They are many and varied. And this investigation will continue past this search now at the scene. And they can be credited for working through many, many leads that have come in from the community. I'd like to thank the community for their support. Every lead, every piece of information has been valuable in getting to this point today, and it will continue, not just when the crime scene is processed, but there'll be many more days and leads and investigative interviews and evidence that will need to happen post this. It has been a huge investigation, and I'm very proud of the work that all the detectives and police across this organisation have put into this investigation to get where we have come today. It is an important time in this investigation that we now know, we believe, we're very confident that we have located Luke and Jesse. I'll hand over to Detective Superintendent Denny Doherty to talk through some of the details. And introduce you to the officer in charge of this investigation. But I'd like to say also that this information did come with the assistance of the accused, for which we're very grateful, and I'm sure the families are very grateful. I'd like to now hand over to Superintendent Doherty. Thank you very much.
Thanks, ma'am. This is, as the Commissioner said, this is a breakthrough for this investigation. Today, it's obviously a mixed emotion for the family. It's a very sad day for them. And we pass our condolences on to the Davies and Baird family. They have been informed by the investigators in relation to the location, we believe, of their loved ones. And I will just talk about how that unfolded about 11 a.m. this morning. Homicide squad detectives attended the NSW at Silverwater, spoke to the accused, just acknowledged Detective Chief Inspector Glenn Brown and Detective Sergeant Sasha Panaza, who's the OIC of this matter, worked tirelessly the last few days. They attended Silverwater Jail and spoke to the accused. As a result of that, he provided assistance to the investigation. We were able to provide a location of where Luke and Jesse were, and as a result of that, about 1 o'clock today, homicide squad detectives attended a location off Gerrara Road at Bungonia. It's about 20 minutes from the original search location, where they have located what they believe are the remains of Luke and Jesse. There were two surf bags have been found. Some other, which has been covered with some debris. There's some other items of interest of significance. They're also located. At that stage, it was declared a crime scene, and immediately the family were informed of the development in this case. And obviously, as the Commissioner said, a crime scene examination will be ongoing for some time. More importantly, arrangements have been made for the family to travel down to the Goulburn area, and we'll provide that ongoing support as we need to. So if you've got any questions, otherwise I'll pass on to Assistant Commissioner Michael Fitzgerald. Okay.
Thank you, Deputy Superintendent Doherty. Thank you, Commissioner. And most importantly, thank you to Detective Sergeant Pinoza, the officer in charge of this investigation. Whilst this news may bring some solace to the Baird and Davies families, I know this will be incredibly heartbreaking for them, and as the Commissioner has said, our sympathies are with them. Today I just want to thank the Homicide Squad. This investigation and the pressure that these officers are under due to what I regard as probably unprecedented public interest in this matter, their work has been nothing short of outstanding, and I just want to actually pass on to the investigators and Detective Superintendent Doherty my genuine thanks. We sadly, as a society, have these type of incidents, domestic violence, that occur in our world, and we have to deal with them, and it has hurt us because it was one of our own officers who was involved in this. So on behalf of myself and the Commissioner, I want to thank these homicide detectives. I only last week acknowledged the amazing work they did of the 7 organised crime murders that we had in 2023. They solved all 7 of them. They're an amazing outfit, and it's something that both myself and the Commissioner are incredibly proud of. Whilst I can't answer all your questions there, I'm happy to take some on board, or I'll hand it on to Detective Superintendent Doherty or the Commissioner.
Why did the accused finally talk?
The accused finally obtained legal counsel this morning, and we were subsequently straight out to jail and asked for his assistance.
Was this the first time you'd actually face-to-face approached him and said, look, what's happened?
Detective Sergeant Pinoza had obviously interviewed him, or attempted to interview him and charged him, but this is the first time that he has willingly told us information.
How many times did you broach that subject, could I ask,
This is a matter before the court, so I probably wouldn't be able to say anything there, Damien.
You've been around a long time. I think Danny looks pretty exhausted too. It's just one of those crimes that really had an impact, didn't it?
Once again, it was a friend of people in this room, from the media, and an officer who's used a police pistol to take 2 innocent people's lives. I spoke to the Commissioner earlier, it's probably attracted the world's attention, let alone Australia's. It's been a horrendous and horrific murders, and once again, we pass on our sympathies to the families.
The families, I mean, and it's a traumatic relief for them, isn't it? How they're obviously being looked after by friends and families and the police themselves. How did you broach that subject? It must have been just so difficult for...
Probably hand that on to Detective Superintendent Doherty. I know they were spoken to within minutes of locating the bodies.
Danny?
Yep. Well, the first phone call was to the families, to let them know. They've had support from a family liaison officer, who's another detective on the investigation, who's been providing that support, and they were informed straight away. And it's probably mixed emotions for them, and you can understand how they may have felt, but at least they have an answer, and they want to travel down to the Goulburn area, and we'll provide as much support as we can and accommodate them.
A number of Jesse's friends have said that Beau was not his ex nor his partner. Can you describe, since you've learned new information, what that relationship was?
My understanding that at some stage we're in a relationship. Again, there's been a lot of information. As the Commissioner said, there's been a mountain of information. This has been a huge investigation. The scope has been far and ranging. And again, there's a lot of evidence that we've gained that there was some type of relationship at some stage, and that's what we'll be alleging in court.
Can I ask the officer in charge, would that be right? The lines of yesterday, that you had the search at Bungonia yesterday, mm-hmm. and it came up empty. you must have walked away from that thinking, you know, very deflated.
Extremely deflated, Simon, absolutely.
Damien.
Oh, Damien, my apologies. I am exhausted. I barely eat nor sleep. We went home last night extremely deflated, but it's not in our nature to give up. So we rallied again this morning and have come upon a wonderful result for the families.
Can you tell us exactly where the bodies were found on the property?
Can I answer? Well, you can answer it if you want. Go on. Where you go?
I apologise. I am not media trained, and I'm not sure what I am allowed to say. They obviously, I have not been to the property. What I understand is that they're found upon a fence line near the entrance to the property.
How close were you yesterday to where they were actually found?
As was said earlier, the property that we were searching was about 20 minutes away. We had a large number of inquiries that we were undertaking to then track movements beyond that location.
Did Lamar say anything else when you interviewed him? Regret, sorrow, any kind of sense of that?
At this stage, we probably wouldn't feel comfortable about exactly what occurred during the interview. He was forthcoming with detectives about the location of the two people.
Can you tell us what state the bodies were found in, other than having bullet wounds?
Again, we've just located a crime scene. It's still being examined. As I said, they're in surf bags. Will be, you know, which is we allege was used to transport the bodies from the house at Paddington. They were covered in debris, and the state of the bodies won't be known until we do a proper crime scene examination, and then obviously from there we'll be able to have a post-mortem conducted as well. So it's a point where it's too early to be able to elaborate on that, and I don't think also, considering the sensitivities around the family, I'm not going to comment on it. Yes, that's right, been treated as a witness. And again, what we will allege is that the accused went to the first property at Bungonia, as been outlined. They did go back to that property at Bungonia, which was the first property that was searched, and then moved those the bodies to the current location, which I said is just off Durara Road at Bungonia.
What's the accused's connection to those properties? Is there any family connection, or why was it those properties in particular?
That's still to be established. In terms of the current location, we've only just located. It doesn't seem to be any connection what we've found so far, but that's all will unfold as the investigation takes place.
Were any other serving New South Wales police officers wittingly or unwittingly involved in assisting the accused in this crime?
No. We've got no evidence at all to suggest that. What we will allege is that this 28-year-old man acted alone, and he is the sole person responsible for the murders of Luke and Jesse. He's the sole person responsible for placing the bodies of Luke and Jesse at this current location, and that's what we'll allege.
The queer community is obviously mourning, Commissioner. What's your message to them?
As I said, my condolences go out to the community. Obviously, Jesse and Luke were an active part of the community, and I look at the photos online and know that they had a great life. So my message to the community is to pass on our condolences and know that the investigators behind me and we as an organisation are doing everything to make sure that the best case is put forward before the court, and we let the court process play out, and after that we begin the healing process in that community. I think that's locating Jesse and Luke today will allow the families and everyone else to take the next step.
Do you regret your choice of the word crime of passion?
I addressed that this morning and a few times today. It is a crime, and I qualified that by saying it's a domestic nature, stalking nature, and we allege a murder, in fact, two murders. The motive for the crime is not a gay hate crime, but more one of that domestic nature. So I again say my apologies if that word upset people, and it wasn't intended that way. It was intended to distinguish it from a gay hate crime.
So, Commissioner, has this case forced a rethink within the force of processes, of any processes?
Oh, we're doing a review. So, firstly, for the investigation itself, it's an investigation led by Homicide Squad. As you know, a police firearm was used, or we allege has been used, and that has led to the incident being declared a critical incident investigation, which necessarily requires that Law Enforcement Conduct Commission will oversee the investigation. And they've been on the ground, I think, since the weekend. So the oversight agency, our oversight agency, is involved. Separate to that, I'm conducting an internal review of our systems around our access to and processes around access to police firearms. And I've spoken to my colleague from Victoria Police, who's offered up a senior officer to help us in that process.
Personally though, what do you see any issues from the outset?
For that issue particularly, or in relation to firearms?
Fine.
Well, we're in this position that a police firearm was used, and that can never happen again. So we've got to look to ways to mitigate that risk in whatever way we can. And I think Victoria Police, simply by its size, the nature of their policing responsibility, and the type of policing operations they conduct, and some lessons they've learnt, I think we can learn from them.
Are you able to explain the process of checking in and checking out guns? Because, you know, allegedly he's checked it out at Miranda and he's checked it back in at Balmain. That's a pretty big distance.
And it
sounds like the officers can just put guns anywhere.
It depends on what level of permissions and approvals have been granted. And in this particular case, it will form part of the investigation, no doubt, which is being oversight. And then more broadly, we're actually reviewing those systems now. For officers in those circumstances. Ordinarily, at a police station that's 24/7, officers come and go from that police station, sign out firearms with access to it via a supervisor, etc. Where we have officers attached to specialist areas in the organisation or undertake other duties, as in this case, was what we term a user pays event. The officer was on a rest day and took on additional duties. Then we need to safeguard that. There's clearly an issue, and we need to mitigate that.
So there needs to be more safeguards?
There does. I can't have this. We don't want this to happen again, and we need to understand how this happens.
How long do you expect that internal investigation to
be? The officer, the senior, we started that review on the weekend, and the senior officer from Victoria has already commenced work.
Sorry, just back on the timeline, you've already covered this, but when do you believe that the body was moved from the first property to the second?
We're trying to establish that still. We think it was sometime on... I'm just trying to get my dates now right.
Wednesday
night, early hours of Thursday morning. So we believe, that's what we'll allege, the accused went down to the Bungonia sometime on Wednesday afternoon, evening, came back to the Sydney area and went back down again and then moved the bodies to the current location.
And you said they were found on a fence line, were they underground?
Well, as I said before, Gerrara Road, there's a driveway that goes up to this property and there's a fence line there, and it's off the side of the driveway, covered in an attempt appears to have been made to cover the bodies with some rocks and debris, and that's all I can say at the moment.
And what led you to the Royal National Park this morning, and did you find any?
We've had a mountain of information that's been coming through. We've had a large team of investigators and other police working on this, and obviously we have to look at all all that information that comes forward and check the veracity. And there's also some searches of evidence that we still need to look at from some other movements that we still trying to establish. But today is about, the focus is on now, the families, providing those answers over the coming hours and days in relation to the circumstances of Luke and Jesse's death, and again, we'll be working with them and for them to get those answers. However, it's not going to just happen right away. I think everyone needs to be a little bit patient. There's going to be some time before we get those answers, but today's a breakthrough. It's an important outcome for the families. So it's an important outcome for the investigation. And, you know, as we things unfold, I'm sure there'll be further updates.
Danny, there was, I know there's a lot of information that's come to you about the behaviour of Bo with other people, things like that. Police be alleging that there was an escalation, perhaps break-ins, other contacts from the accused and Jesse in the lead-up to this?
Oh, look, again, I'm not going to comment on things that are now going to be before the court. However, that's obviously an obvious line of inquiry, was his behaviour and his pattern of his behaviour prior to what we allege is a double homicide. And they're obvious lines that we are currently making and will continue to make.
Danny, can you tell us how many bullets were discharged from the officer's Glock?
No, all we can say is that, as I said the other day, we can confirm that a firearm's been discharged there, and today we'll be able to get some more answers about what you've asked in relation to whether a firearm was actually used on to kill Luke and Jesse. However, we can't establish at this stage how many bullets were actually fired from his firearm. All we can say is it has matched the accused firearm, and that's important that we have made that ballistic match. And then it will unfold down the, once we make more inquiries, especially after the crime scene's been examined and we have the post-mortem finalised, we'll be able to have some more answers for the family.
And can you tell us, what is the current status of employment for the accused of New South Wales Police? Is he suspended without pay?
And what happened? Without pay, I've been told by the Commissioner.
Commissioner, can I ask you, given the high-profile nature of this case and just how much pressure has come in the wake of it, how relieved were you today when you heard the news that the boys have been found?
Very relieved because of the families. I've spoken to both families. They've arrived from interstate. They've been waiting for news. And each day, each hour was, you know, an agonising wait. So I'm relieved for the families. As the officer in charge has said and the detectives have said, we've been working around the clock on this for the families to find Luke and Jesse, and I'm pleased that we've found them. Of course, it's tragic, an awful circumstance, but I think that as a parent, and I know when I spoke to Luke's mum, that's what parents want. They want to know where their children are.
Commissioner, are you going to march in the Mardi Gras parade with the rest of police this Saturday? Has there been a breakthrough?
We went to a meeting today with Mardi Gras. It was a fruitful discussion. That's just the start of a discussion, so we'll continue.
Would the police be happy to march without uniform?
That's something we'll consider, and obviously I haven't ruled it out either, and those decisions, as the Commissioner, I can make those decisions, and I will talk with both for the corporate sponsor and some of those officers to see how they feel. And they're, like a lot of us, we've all been rocked. And there's some positives that could come out of participating in Mardi Gras Saturday, but we're really, it's early days, and we've got a few days left yet to work through this with Mardi Gras. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.